Welcome back. I guess Indian gurus have been in vogue over recent years in the West. The Beatles introduced us to the Maharishi. The Orange People blindly followed the Bhagwan. But there have been others far more credible and far more respectable. My next guest is a Bombay lady whose following is growing around the world. She says that that you have the power to deal positively with every problem, from con men to cancer. All you have to do is know how to tap into it, to tap into that power. Would you please welcome the lady acclaimed as India's greatest living saint, the mother of Sahaja Yoga, Sri Mataji. Welcome. I know it's welcome to Australia. I know that it's very difficult for you, for anyone, to sum up one's religion, but is it possible to say what is Sahaja Yoga?
Sahaja. Saha means with. Ja is born with you. This is born with you. Within us is the power which can give us the status of a spirit. We are not yet the spirit. We are at a human level. And in the evolutionary process, we have to now have the breakthrough to become the spirit. That's very essential and is absolutely eventually the all possible natural thing that has to happen. It should happen to all of us. And the time has come for you to get to that position where you become the spirit. All the religions have talked about it and told about it. But people have gone wrong in believing that artificially, if you say that you are baptized or you have become a Brahmin or you have become a peer, that you have become the spirit. It's not that. It's a happening that has to take place within ourselves, which is a living process, absolutely living process of the living divine force within ourselves.
How does this, we've heard of lots of yogas, how does this differ from other Indian yogas?
Other yogas were practiced mostly after getting realization, but as it has come from some half-baked people, it is in a very funny way that people follow it as if they have to take all the medicines together and they don't know any discrimination about it. Unless and until you make this force rise within you, you will not know what type of attention is needed and what type of physical exercise is needed. Indiscriminately, people do physical exercises getting into troubles.
Now you speak of the force. Is it possible to say what this? Where does this force emanate from?
This force is a residual power in our triangular bone called as sacrum.
Sacrum. Okay.
Now the sacrum is where it comes from Greek, and that means Greek people knew this was a sacred bone. It rises from there, passes through our six centers, piercing through our fontanel bone area, and you get the cool breeze of the Holy Ghost coming out of our head.
That's what Christians refer to,
isn't it? Yes. I mean, Holy Ghost, what is the Holy Ghost? Nobody can explain, but Holy Ghost is very simple to understand. This is the reflection of the Holy Ghost within us. Holy Ghost is the desire of God. God himself watches the working of the desire, and the desire is that we all should become the spirit. And this desire is reflected in our triangular bone in 3.5 points.
When is this the central nervous system?
No, it is in the triangular bone. It's this force, this is the fourth force within us.
Okay. See,
we have sympathetic nervous system, left and right, and we have got autonomous, that is an autonomous nervous system, and parasympathetic, and we have also central nervous system. Now, this is the system which is not yet working. It is still in the triangular bone. When it rises, it gives you a new dimension of the spirit. It means the light of the spirit comes in our attention. In that case, what happens is very simple to understand, that at human level, we are not in the absolute state. Not in the absolute state. That's why there's a chaos. Supposing I'm holding a snake in my hand, you see, and there's no light. Somebody tells me that there's a snake, I will not throw it away. I would not like to listen to anybody's advice about it. But if there's a light, I'll throw it away. In the same way, when you become the spirit, the light of the spirit guides you. You become your own master, you become your own guru. You don't have to have any guru for that. This piercing of the fontanel bone by the kundalini gives you the power of the spirit.
But we'll demonstrate it later, at least we'll give you a chance to demonstrate later, but you're talking about a physical power, a spirit that comes out of the top of your head.
No, it's an energy.
An energy, all right.
It's an energy which comes out of your fontanel bone area, touching the spirit. But the spirit actually resides in the heart. But the main seat of the heart is here, in the fontanel bone area. And it pierces through. When it pierces through, actually it should pierce. It's not just I say I baptize you. It's not like that. It has to pierce through that, and you have to feel the cool breeze of the Holy Ghost on top of your head.
Is it there now?
Yes, it's there.
Can I feel it?
I don't know if you'll feel it or not, because you'll have to have that sensitivity. Now, you see, all around, also that all-pervading power is there, which makes everything vibrate. But this energy can be felt only when you have got that realization. Then what happens is that all your centers on your fingertips become sensitive. And you can feel, this is written in the Quran, that your hands will speak when you will get to your resurrection.
Yes.
This is the resurrection.
But Natasha, you must know, you must realize, I mentioned the Maharishi and I mentioned the Bhagwan and so on. You must live with the skeptics and the doubters because of those.
I'm living with them all the time.
The con men have come
yes.
before you.
Yes. Now, firstly, you see, the great mistake we commit as far as going to gurus or to anything that is religious is that you cannot pay for God. You see, it's a living process of a living God. Now, supposing you want to sprout a seed, how much money do you pay to the Mother Earth? It's a very simple thing, but people don't understand. They think that they can purchase everything. You cannot purchase God. A simple method, if you apply to all of them, they will all run away.
Yes. Now, again, I read that that this spirit, this power you speak of, can deal with, as I said, I mentioned the comment, but can deal with cancer, can
yes.
deal with AIDS.
Yes.
I've had some Australians talk about their children being heroin addicts and eliminating
yes,
heroin.
Yes, of course, it can.
Power.
It does. Because, see, I'll show you now, this is the center. We can say this is the middle of Longetta, or we can say this is through which the central canal is passing. Now, the center is inside here. Now, when we are in the imbalance, say we go too much towards the left side, means we become too emotional or do all kinds of wrong, nonsensical conditioning. Then, or if we go too much to the right, in the ego and all that, you see, then we break this. Once we break this, what happens? That the center becomes constricted and the energy becomes constricted. Slowly it breaks the relationship with the head, foot, the whole, and it becomes malignant. When it becomes malignant, it starts overpowering other cells. And that's how cancer sets in. Now, when the Kundalini rises, what she does, she enlightens this center. Yeah, first of all. She brings it back normal, and then she goes up there, pierces through, by which she does one great thing, is to make you in contact with the all-pervading power. And once that power starts flowing through you, you don't have to worry. You become absolutely peaceful. All your troubles are over. Practically, most of the troubles can be over once you are a spirit.
All right. Well, it's very difficult to understand and understand it cold as I'm doing now. You've offered to give a demonstration with the with our audience?
Yes, I think I'll try, but
would you like?
A very short time. And they are all in a hurry, I think, to catch the buses or something.
No, they've got tons of time.
All right.
Tons of time.